Hello, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. A little while back I pre-purchased an upgrade to Capture One to the new 2020 version. I've now received the email saying the software's available, so today I'm going to talk you through some of the changes in this latest version. The first one we'll look at is the crop tool. This has had a very simple change, which is adding drag handles to the edges of the crop frame. Strangely, this has made it a lot easier to see and use. The developers also added a couple of modifier keys you can use when cropping. If you hold down the Option or Alt key on your keyboard, the crop changes from the center of the crop area rather than from the edges. When you drag from one edge normally, the crop only changes that side. But if you hold down the Option or Alt key whilst dragging, the crop changes so that both sides change relative to the center. The other modifier key is the Shift key. Hold down Shift whilst dragging the crop area and it locks the aspect ratio of the crop. You can even hold down both modifier keys together to lock the aspect ratio of the crop and crop from the center at the same time. Personally, I don't have much use for the modifier keys, but I know there are quite a lot of people out there who will appreciate the enhancement. The next change I want to mention are the shortcut keys. Two of them that I think are particularly useful are the full stop key, and that zooms you into 100% magnification, and if you want to fit the image to the preview window, press the comma key. There are also a few other minor interface changes, but whilst they might be minor, they do improve the overall working experience. Now, one of the big changes that I want to look at is the basic color editor. This is now more compact and has 8 rather than 6 colour zones, and there are a few other changes. It's probably best to demonstrate how this works rather than focus on the differences. Start by picking a colour zone in one of two ways. First, you can click the coloured squares and then make any adjustments. Notice you can now see an indication of the sliders effect on the colour range. Alternatively, you can use the colour picker tool and select the colour zone by clicking the image. After that, I can adjust the sliders to affect the colour. I can also, though, click and drag up and down with the adjuster to change the saturation. If I drag left and right, I change the hue. I can also hold down my Option or Alt key whilst dragging from left and right and change the lightness. Now, if you don't like these settings, you can change them using the new Settings option. Here you can see the hue has the horizontal adjustment, saturation vertical, and lightness is alt and horizontal. But you've got other options. It's also possible to see and change the color zones by clicking the options icon. This opens the color range editor, showing the width of each of the color zones. These relate to the swatches that you see here. Also notice there's an option to view the selected colour range. When this is active, the image becomes desaturated apart from the colour you've selected. This allows you to see the affected area more clearly. Now, if you select and move the edge of the segment, you can increase or decrease the range of colour that it affects. You also have a smoothness slider, and this helps you to blend the transition between the zones to become more natural. Watch what happens to the edges here when I move the slider left and right. As you can see, when I move the slider smoothness to its maximum value, the zone between the different segments becomes more blurred. That is the blending effect that takes place. Once you're happy, just click apply. But for me, the big improvement is that I can now use this tool on adjustment layers. I'm not restricted to just using it on the background layer. Now let's look at one of my favourite tools, which is the high dynamic range adjustment. The old tool was very effective at recovering highlights and shadow detail from RAW files, but sometimes the sliders didn't give enough control. Well, this tool's now had a makeover, and we now have white and black sliders. If you've never used this tool before, let me show you how effective it can be. I shot this image using a Fuji X-T3, and it's underexposed by about 2 stops. I also didn't use a filter, so perhaps it's even underexposed by more. Now, if I use the exposure slider to correct the dark areas, the sky becomes blown out. But if I now use the high dynamic range sliders, I can correct the image. Now, if you're thinking, big deal, lots of RAW converters have these 4 sliders, I don't blame you. What's different about the sliders in Capture One, in my opinion, is that the results look totally natural and the colours are absolutely excellent. And once I've recovered the dynamic range from the RAW file, I can adjust the image further using the Levels and Curves tool. And everything is looking natural. This is a really good result. Now, we only have this area of dark rocks to deal with, and I can do that using a radial gradient adjustment layer. Now, here's where you'll find further interface changes. I can now see and select the different types of tools to adjust the image with. I can also change the masking options. I'm not needing to mess around with drop-downs and pop-ups to deal with the adjustments that I want to make, and this is making the software much easier to work with. I think this is a huge improvement over the previous version. Now, to make my changes, I'll add a radial gradient. And to ensure that I don't adjust any of the highlight areas in error, I'll make this a luma range. And I can change this to just deal with the darkest areas in the image. Now, there's also another improvement to the interface that I want to show you. I can take any of these blocks of controls and I can actually pin them to the pinned area at the top. So now, when I scroll up and down, I don't lose the tool. It's pinned here so that I can access it easily. And when I'm done with it, I can remove it and move it back to the scrollable area. Again, a small change, but it really makes a difference to when you're working with the image. Now let's recover the dark rocks in this area using this radial gradient. And that's created a very believable result. If I zoom into the area at 100%, You can see the result is excellent. It doesn't seem to matter that we've done lots and lots of recovery work in that area. It's still a very good, believable result. Now let's look at the image side by side with the original. We've been working on a clone version, so here's the original image. And side by side you can see that we've made loads of recovery and we've ended up with a very clean, detailed image that looks very natural. The original is well underexposed as you can see, and it's quite amazing how much the software has managed to pull back. Now there are other enhancements and changes to the software. I focused on what's important to me as a landscape photographer. If you want to learn about the other changes, don't just watch the short promotional video on the website. After searching the website, I've actually found a few pages that summarise the changes quite well. I'll include the link in the video details below. And I also want to stress that if you're thinking of upgrading or buying Capture One, be sure to download the trial version and spend some time using it. Now I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, please share it with others. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you next time for another video.